empiezo con esa en tierra natal, Argentina, pero en su momento voy a ponerme en inglés para que mi colega pueda comprender directamente lo que vamos a compartir. Gracias por la invitación. Justo hace 2 semanas estuve acá con una colega para publicar un nuevo libro que se llama De socios en conflicto a socios en paz. Porque nosotros en esa manera de hacer muchos ejercicios consideramos de que, aunque a veces los dos lados están muy peleados, si uno se pone a escarbar, va a encontrar que tiene algún atributo común. Se consigue hablar de ser humano, pero en el caso nuestro, evidentemente, el lenguaje, la religión, la cultura, tiene muchas cosas que entre palestinos y israelíes nos unen. Entonces estamos construyendo sobre lo que nos une para lograr el conflicto de la paz. Es el último libro que publiqué en Buenos Aires con una colega. Entonces estar acá después de 2 semanas, precisamente, no sé si es un récord para alguien en Cali, pero para mí estar en el mismo lugar después de 2 semanas es un récord increíble. Por eso estar agradecido. If you allow me, I'll switch now into English, so that I talk to the dialogue with my colleague directly. I'm very flattered that I was given the floor first, but just to put the record straight, we work in a total framework of equality. There's no asymmetry between my colleague and myself. We have been team teaching together for 20 years at the University of Maryland. And after 20 years of being equally old, the only reason why I go fast, I guess, is age, you know, in the Middle East.
And beauty.
I wouldn't pass such judgment, but age for sure. Beauty is in the eyes of the beholder. Beauty, not in our eyes. Yes, and also earlier in the alphabet, he should go first, as a young Kaufman, you know. Or if you go Israel and Palestine, I go first, Israel being. But we never quarrel anymore about who should go first. Because we know each other so well, there's no point to repeat ourselves. And what we're going to do is I'm going to explain the title with many facts about potential peace plans, even at this very dire and difficult time. You know, I don't know if the language that has more proverbs than any other language in the world is Arabic. And I have searched that to be the case. We have one saying in Spanish, "Ama el tiempo buena cara." And I challenge my colleague now, or any Arab speaker in the audience, to find the Arab proverb that will probably be even wiser than his saying "Ama el tiempo buena cara." Because we are in a terrible horrible time. We're in a deep crisis, obviously, for people to start thinking about peace opportunities. When the, as people say, blood is still in the river, maybe academics can do a better job than people in government or military. And that's what we're trying to do. We're in a crisis, and I've been told, I hope that I'm right, is that in the Chinese language, when you talk about the crisis, there are 2 signs that explain the word crisis. The first one talks about threats, and the second one about opportunities. But this is the crisis. So we want to highlight, I hope that any ambassador who serves in China will not contradict me, because I don't speak Chinese, but I've learned to hear that this is the case. 2 signs, threat and opportunity. And if this is the case, I'm going to speak about opportunities. There are so many threats that my colleague has a very nice thing about being pessimist and optimist. And I was told that a pessimist is an informed optimist, you know? So it's really not so easy to be an optimist now, but we need to move on, that is clear. So I want to give you a list, and you will analyze in depth, and also perhaps if he wants to say the one he likes, you know, it's a free country. I can also say from the long list of these opportunities or plans, but we're not going to do it only if you ask, because we, as an academic, like to present all with equal respect. Although some are better than others. What are the parameters or the variables that we have to classify what are counted to be 7 or 8 these opportunities? The first one is all new. Is there anything new? They are all old and can be recycled, the old ones. Maybe failed ones, because if they were old, maybe they didn't succeed. The other one, in our case, is very clear cut, is a two-state solution or one-state solution. I mean, Israel, Palestine, as neighbors, or a state that maybe called something else, maybe called today Israel, tomorrow will be Palestine, but only one state. So that's another parameter variable. The third one is more the pessimist or the optimist, I would say. People talk a lot now about conflict management and not conflict resolution or conflict transformation, which is my preference. What is the difference? Conflict management says they can't make peace now. So cut your losses and go minimal to whatever you can do, just to minimal. The absence of war, that's about it. The conflict resolution people, and we definitely are part of it too, we want to see a disagreement. And the conflict transformation people say disagreement is not enough. It's a 100-year-old conflict. It's not a conflict between two governments. It's a conflict between people versus people, nation versus nation. So you need to prepare also for reconciliation. So it's an entire transformation. From a lot of hatred, as we have, at the level of the nation, it's not only the government, both sides, to, I'm not saying love and hugging and kissing, but out of the hatred and reconciliation. So some of the plans are so going far away that people say, you really are naive, look what's going on. And honestly, I've read a few things about conflict transformation, which is what we do. I was so happy to be at CARI about a year ago with a group of Cuban and American, North American academics presenting recommendations for normalization between Cuba and the USA. I'm sure Cuba-USA will be very easy to move from conflict resolution, I hope, to conflict transformation. Cubans like baseball and so on and so on. But we have great difficulties to think about conflict. I'm talking about the variable, conflict management, conflict resolution, conflict transformation. The other one is either you move into stages like the Oslo process, 5 years of partial measures, confidence building measures, and then 2 years of planning to deal with the most difficult things of the conflict. That's one option, to go back into a prolonged process, or as my colleague has said very often, until you see white smoke, you put everybody in the room, take the key, and you don't let them out until they finish, and you see the white smoke like the Indians, you know, from the tent. So this is the question, whether are you going to have stage by stage, or come on, we have done it, failed, or strong, and now final, everything. So that's another. And the other one, which has been quite a dilemma for the Palestinians that are trying to move on, obviously, we have the Palestinian Authority is much more energetic in trying to move on towards a solution than my Israeli government. I say it as an academic because it can be clearly proven that. So the Palestinians have a question whether you negotiate and you rebel at the same time, or you know, like an intifada, people think about the third uprising, rebellion, the third intifada. Or if you really want to negotiate, you cannot do the two things at the same time. Or maybe as President Abbas, who says no more an armed intifada like the second intifada, he criticized what he called a militarized intifada. Maybe a popular intifada, that's the name I heard, being used popular, which means a lot of protest at the same time to negotiate. And there is like a small distinction between being non-lethal, namely not using missiles, not using weapons, but maybe stones and cocktail molotovs, as it's now happening in Jerusalem these very days. I won't say it's not lethal, but they have no arms, no weapons, I mean just stones and cocktails. So all these dilemmas, as I say, are variables. I counted about six, maybe my colleague can add. Where do you place your peace initiative? And now I go into the listing very quickly of the seven type of initiative that are still on the table, still on the table. The first one, and the most popular one, is a two-state solution. And you have it all written already. In fact, there's already a 35-page peace plan that has been presented in Geneva some more than a decade ago by an Israeli minister, Yossi Begin from the left, and Yasser Abu Rabo, a minister of the Palestinian Authority, very close to Abu Mazen. The idea, in fact, my colleague may be shy, but when the Geneva Accord was signed in Geneva, he was called by President Arafat to come to see him next day because he's going to retreat in Geneva. President Arafat's speech about this peace initiative. My colleague here, he may not mention it because he's too modest, but I am a witness because he was at my place in Jerusalem visiting when a very important Rajoub Jibril called him and told him, Manuel, tomorrow morning you go to Nogata, you have to talk to our president because you are leaving the next day to Geneva. Am I right, Manuel? All right. So the two-state solution is, on paper, a complete solution. They did not finish the water thing at that time, because we're talking about refugees, borders, security, settlements, Jerusalem, and also water. So, I mean, the more difficult elements like refugees and Jerusalem that are the most difficult ones, the Oslo process deferred it to the end. But when it did not crystallize at the meeting of Clinton, Arafat, and Barak campaign in 2000, then the civil society took the initiative to translate it in 35 pages of details like a professional disciple. But it didn't work. But then we have the shorter version for those who want to only read one page, maybe two pages. They are called the Clinton parameters. When President Clinton was only mediating in Camp David and not coming up with solutions, he repented maybe. He should have come up with solutions. But then when they left, Barak and Arafat, he came up he spoke. So the people were taking notes, never voted, but they spoke. The Clinton parameters were sent to Sharm el-Sheikh. There was a meeting there. And in January 2001, when everything was breaking down, the Intifada Al-Aqsa started, the falling government of Barak accepted it, but collapsed. There was no point. And Arafat also had a positive reaction with some qualifications, so he never failed. I mean, the timing was wrong. I wish he would have said that a year earlier. A towards Big Bang. So we have these two state solution. First, most important one, all concise in two pages for people who want to read. The second one is a variation that is extremely, I would say it's quite new or renovated, because it says the slogan is two states in one country. Two states in one country. What does it mean? Well, because the facts of the terrain are very difficult to make possible to implement the two-state solution, or to say very clearly, because of the settlements that are making the Palestinian state not a viable state because of continuity and so on, the idea is, look, there will be, maybe like Mercosur in many ways, a free passage for merchandise, people, residents between Israel and Palestine. You are a Palestinian, you can go and work in Tel Aviv, you can even rent or buy a place. You are an Israeli, you can live in your settlement near Hebron, you are very religious, okay, you can live there, you can work there, except that you will always go in your state. Once in 4 years, comes the time to go. The Israeli who lives in Palestine goes in Israel. The Palestinian who lives in Israel goes in Palestine. And it's very similar. I don't know about Mercosur, it seems to me that it's pretty similar too. But it's definitely similar to the Benelux that people of my age, you, some of you remember, that the unity of Europe started with these three countries, Belgium, Luxembourg, and Netherlands, saying you can do whatever you want, no customs, nothing, nothing, no passport, nothing. But when it comes to vote, the Belgians vote to Belgium, as it is now in the European Union at large. That's basically what we have. The third solution is pretty dramatic, and I would call it in a slogan, throw the keys, throw the keys. I want to refer to my colleague, Professor Zazian again. You are not, are you having your uniform?
I don't have
to have
uniform.
Oh, okay. I was, the throw the keys is very inventive, so he, I don't know if he coined the word throw the keys, but he has much to do with it, which is called the, how can I say, called the block of Israel. You know, and it has been coming time and again, especially when President Abbas is upset. Saber Katz, he gets upset a lot. He was a professor when I was a professor, and I know him very well from his young days. And he says, you know, fed up, the Israeli occupation, there's no change, it's getting worse by the day. So President Abbas, take the keys, give it to Netanyahu, and say, I'm going back to be the PLO. I'm also the chair of the PLO. And we're going to be a liberation movement, and we're going to fight you, not violently, but as a liberation movement. There's no way we can be a state under your occupation. So I'll take it, and we're going to fight you democratically, with like Gandhi, whatever you want to say. We'll fight you. You are doing neo-colonialism, we'll fight you. It's an interesting proposition. It's a little bit dangerous, but I'm not judging. I'm only presenting the fact. The next one is to say, like the Palestinians are now doing this year at the General Assembly of the United Nations, we will present a plan that will be a plan for peace and ending occupation in the year 2015 or 16. And we have the United Nations to resolve and pass a resolution, because you have done it before. It's not the first time that you're going to tell what needs to be the resolution. In my plan, I talk about that, I present a clear-cut line of our borders. You should ask Prime Minister Netanyahu to present a clear-cut plan about what these things are the Israeli borders. We are now a state. Israel is a state, so we have a border dispute. Above all, we We have a territorial border dispute. Suppose there are issues, other issues are like, you know, refugees, what I want to secure. But from Latin America, you know, there have been many countries that had a border dispute. I was involved in a conflict resolution project after the Cenepa war between Peru and Ecuador in 1995. So there have been a lot of three wars between Ecuador and Peru, where we have plenty of wars, more wars. But you know, we have wars, there are two states, it's not clear where the border is. We want cooperation of borders, we did our share, 67 borders. Maybe I don't even say with border modifications, I just say my wish, 67 borders, you decide, becoming the UN. Or another variation of this solution is to tell the Security Council now, say, look, you are very responsible for the partition plan of 1947. In the partition plan of mandatory Palestine, mandatory British, mandatory Palestine, you opted for a solution that basically there was a Jewish state and an Arab state. They were not even given names at that time. Israel was not renamed in 47. This 47, and you gave us a map. Please give us a map for 2015. I want to say, 47, the Palestinians and the Arab countries rejected the partition. Now, while Palestine is being offered less than before, it was at that time offered 45% of mandatory Palestine. Now, in the best case, the Palestinian Authority is asking for 22%. Suppose whatever the Security Council would say, then we most likely will accept it in Palestine. Most likely will accept it. Let's see what happens to Israel. I mean, we have learned our lesson, put it this way. From 47, we missed an opportunity. Now, maybe Israel don't want to miss an opportunity. And then I try to finish quickly with two more that are not coming from the Israeli side. You just mentioned some coming solutions from the Palestinian side. One is called only conflict management. There's no way we can make peace. There's no partner. There's no partner. That's the slogan. Unfortunately, initiated by Barak, not even by this government. We had a very strong and wise ambassador to the US for many years, an academic who writes really good books. His name is Michael Oren, a colleague of mine in my days when I was at the Peace Institute of the Hebrew University. He was perhaps the best ambassador Israel had for years. Representative government of Netanyahu. But when he finished, and he's now a professor at a private university called Interdisciplinary Center in Syria, where I also teach now, he came up with a plan called more or less following what Sharon did in Gaza when he had done unilateral withdrawal without any negotiation. Now he's saying, Michael Warren, when it comes to the West Bank, the gap is too big between the Israeli government and people, you know, in the democracy. As I say, we have to also blame the people, not only the government. That's what the people of Israel really want. So Oren says, unilateral withdrawal to the area where we have built Israel itself, a fence or a wall. You know, part is a fence, part is a wall, which is not even finished yet, by the way, paradoxically. But it's about, I'm talking about between 9 to 10% or 8 to 10% of Palestinian territories. It means depriving the Palestinians from the 22% to take 2%, and 2% would be like 10% of the Palestinian territory. And not make peace. Okay, it's impossible to make peace. I know the Palestinians are not going to accept it, but reality sometimes are stronger. Pay attention, in 1949, when the borders of Israel were like before 67, Israel controlled 78%, yeah, in 49. Palestinians did not, Palestinians were out of the picture, that's unfortunate. But the Arab countries did not accept it, and they only signed armistice agreements, armistice ceasefire lines, but not permanent. Right? So Ambassador Oren is saying, Macias will not accept it, but then comes Arafat 40 years later and is accepting the armistice borders. So we wait 40 years, Macias will not accept now this change. That I will think also in Jerusalem, by the way, Jerusalem will be part of the Israeli side. And then after 40 years, we are strong, militarily strong. After 40 years, they will maybe accept, as they did, you know, from 88, they accepted the borders of 48. The 19th Palestinian National Council meeting accepted 40 years later the borders that they did not accept in 48. And the last one, which is, I would say, the initiative of this government, which basically is saying, do nothing, do nothing. Sounds not very much like a key solution. Do nothing. We do wars every time. We used to have wars once a decade. And now, lately in Gaza, we have wars every 2 years, or 3 years. And 2009, 2012, 2014. I don't know that you can say do nothing is a solution, but the more enlightened people around Netanyahu, like a former minister of defense, also a professor, Moshe Abetz, is saying, and we had a recent seminar about for a few days with the diplomats, and it came up not to put, I mean, to declare the occupied territories to be Israel, like Israel did with each of us. So all is Israel. And for the new potential citizens, the 2.5 million Gaza, forget it. We don't want Gaza, they can have an independent state in Gaza. When it comes to Judea, Samaria, as it could be called, West Bank, what we suggest is a process of becoming citizen over time, like you would call in the US a green card, they would be allowed to have all the rights except voting rights, like a green card, you know, you don't have voting rights in the US. It's like a temporary resident. Of course, they are natives, you know, big issue. When you are an immigrant, they put you under probation for 5 years. It's one thing, but if you are native and you're born there, to be put under probation, it doesn't seem to be very reasonable. But I have one Palestinian, we have one Palestinian colleague, who is a Maverick, Salim Seiba, who was a former president of Marcus University, such a, I'm going to say, imagination without limits, who say, look, you don't want to have the two-state solution? So second best for the Palestinians is one-state solution. And you don't want to give us citizens now, but you would give us citizens after 5 years or so, but don't wait. Okay. You want to see how loyal we are, we want to be loyal, and so on. We're not going to vote for 5 years. And then we show our loyalty to the state, and then we are citizens. So that's the only voice I heard from Palestinians. And I'm finished, but you see that there is quite a menu. I mean, not to be totally pessimistic, and then people say, you know, out of despair, there's no solution. I say, when there is an earthquake or a tsunami, the human beings have to face nature, and still we don't have solutions to nature-made conflict. But we, in our area of the world, especially Israel-Palestine, we are making our own, these are human-made conflicts. This is not nature. And when we are talking about human-made conflicts, we should look for human-made solutions. Except that after 100 years, I know that the past can impact the present, but cannot determine the present. And as Einstein said, solutions for human-made problems have to be with a paradigm change. You have to change the paradigm. And that's where good minds should put their minds on the two sides, not only to list, that's also a good thing that we can list all the solutions that you know. But then to choose the best of any of the solutions, working together and then come up with a new paradigm that will change. So I stop here. My colleague is going to go more in depth into what is six, is more viable, less viable. And I don't know, leave it up to the end if you want to know our personal opinions. It's not important because we're talking as academics. It's not even talking as a diplomat, it's talking as an academic. Thank you.